The holidays are a time of the year when people get together with their loved ones, and it's often a period for reflection and intimate conversations. Tonight, we look at a kind of unique oral history project that's built a legacy from gathering thousands of those kinds of conversations and many more. Its founder just won a major award for his work, which may be well known to many of our viewers. Our Sreenivasan recorded this conversation in our New York studios.
Time now for StoryCorps.
For more than a decade, the StoryCorps Project has been recording and archiving the stories of everyday Americans, more than 50,000 in all so far, that are as varied as a family of five becoming homeless and forced to move into a shelter.
I remember pulling my hood over my head because I was embarrassed. I didn't want her to see me, you know. Or a colleague says, we're going to go volunteer and we're going to feed the families, and it would be at my shelter.
To an Alzheimer's patient speaking with his wife about his losses.
One thing that I experience with Alzheimer's is I live in the moment because I can't remember what happened yesterday. I can't remember what happened 10 minutes ago.
To a mother speaking with a man who killed her son.
I just hugged the man that murdered my son. And I instantly knew that all that anger and the animosity, all the stuff I had in my heart for 12 years for you, I knew it was over.
StoryCorps' vision comes from its creator, Dave Isay. The idea? Get two people together in a room or booth with a microphone, primarily friends or loved ones, and let them talk and listen to each other. It began with a soundproof booth in Grand Central Station in New York City. Today, the project has a van that travels around the country, as well as recording rooms in several cities. The stories are archived at the Library of Congress in Washington, D.C., but they also are made available to the public more easily. Excerpts are heard each Friday on NPR, often emotional ones. Like the case of an Arkansas woman who took it on herself to provide caring for AIDS patients in the early days of the crisis when no one else would.
I marched myself out to the nurse's station and I said, can we call his mother? And they go, honey, his mama's not coming. He's been here 6 weeks. Nobody's coming. And so I went back in, and he looked up at me and he said, oh, mama, I knew you'd come. I stayed with him for 13 hours while he took his last breath.
PBS broadcasts animated stories based on the audio.
That morning, we loaded into the vehicle, and I get tapped on the shoulder, and I got told that I need to bounce up to the next vehicle. I said, catch you guys on the flip side, and that was the last thing I ever said to him. Next thing I know, I just hear the loudest explosion, and I see that's my squad's vehicle that got hit.
StoryCorps has found ways of refining its mission over the years. It has special initiatives for military families, teachers, gays and lesbians, and others. Now, Isay has won a $1 million prize from TED Talks and a chance to continue expanding the StoryCorps model. Joining me now is Dave Isay, the founder of StoryCorps. Thanks for being with us.
Hi, Ari. Good to be here.
All right, so six Peabodys, a MacArthur genius, more than 50,000 interviews. How did we get here?
Well, you know, it's a very simple idea. We set up a booth in Grand Central Terminal where two people can come and have a conversation about their life with the help of a trained facilitator. Crazy idea, and it just worked, you know, and here we are. It's really a project about connection, giving people a chance to listen to one another and recognize, you know, the value in their lives and the lives of others.
So what is it that empowers people to share the way that they do? I mean, some of these are very intimate and personal stories.
Yeah, I mean... all of them. 50,000, as you said. I think there's a formality in that interview setting, the fact that every interview goes to the Library of Congress, and of course, as you know, the power of the microphone to give you the license to ask things and to say things you don't normally get to say. I think a lot of people think of StoryCorps, there's kind of a mortality piece to it, and it's a chance for people, they know that this is a record that's going to outlive them, they know they're speaking to future generations, and just magical things happen.
You know, there's a lot of our listeners, our viewers also listen to NPR in the mornings. How difficult is it to distill a 40-minute conversation down into 3 minutes or 2 minutes or 5 minutes or whatever it is?
And what we distill one out of every 300 40-minute conversations down to 3 minutes. So we have a great, we have a brilliant production team who edits these things. But, you know, to us, every interview is equally valuable. You know, we think of it as potentially, you know, a sacred moment in people's lives. But some of them have this kind of universal quality about them, which almost kind of demand that they be shared with a larger audience.
You have essentially an archive of America in a way that history books don't, that you've actually captured the stories of the citizenry.
Yeah.
Right? I mean, that's different than when school kids will thumb through a history book and say, sure, what was happening at that time? I mean, you've actually kind of got a cross-section of people, at least in the last 11 years, yeah, of what America was like.
Up through the voice of everyday people, yeah. The great oral historian Studs Terkel cut the ribbon on our first booth all those many years ago, and he was a great proponent of bottom-up history. You know, history is so often told from the top down, from statesmen and politicians and famous people and rich people, but there's such value, there's such richness to hearing these stories through our voices, through the voices of regular people.
So how has it made you and your team of producers different? I mean, this is, you know, we only hear a tiny fraction, yeah, of all the stories that come through StoryCorps.
Yeah. Well, I mean, it's in many ways, it's history, but it's also kind of collecting the wisdom of humanity because of the nature of what's talked about in the booth. We have a small production team. We have lots of facilitators who travel the country, you know, bearing witness to these interviews. And I think, you know, personally for me, it's made me much more hopeful these last 11 years. You know, we've been in, you know, all 50 states, thousands of cities across the political spectrum, every kind of person you can imagine. And the facilitators who are out there collecting the wisdom of humanity invariably come back. And if you ask them what they've learned, they, you know, it's a very high-stress job. They're very emotional interviews, and it's boom, 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 interview after interview. And if you ask them, they say, you know, that they've learned that people are basically good. Every one of them, you know. And the other thing they'll say is that if you think you can judge the interior life of someone by how they look or how they're dressed, you're always going to be wrong.
Okay, so as you said, all these interviews are archived forever, yes, in the Library of Congress. And you've actually made it a point to go into different communities as,
yes,
well. I mean, you focused in on military conversations. You focused in on the LGBTQ community.
Yeah.
Why?
Well, you know, StoryCorps, I used to make documentaries, social justice documentaries. And StoryCorps, I created StoryCorps because I came to believe when I was doing these interviews in wherever it was I was, prisons, homeless shelters, that people being listened to, the act of being listened to, you could almost see people's backs straighten, you know? And we have a commitment at StoryCorps to make sure that the voices of those who may feel least heard are celebrated through StoryCorps, and that you know, people can recognize the, you know, grace and beauty and power in their own stories wherever they are, whoever they are.
Going forward, where,
yeah,
does StoryCorps go? You're 11 years old now.
Yeah.
Let's say and 10 years from now, we're having this conversation. What's happened?
Well, we're working hard to turn StoryCorps into a sustaining national institution. I mean, I feel like we're at the first yard line, like at the very beginning of a long game. StoryCorps is about, you know, it's about listening. It's about, at this time of like huge divide, it's about recognizing the value in everybody's story. And really, if you're just going to sum it up in one language, it's realizing that, you know, every life matters, and every life matters kind of equally and infinitely. So I feel like we have a very, 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 very long way to go. But I have an amazing group of people who I work with at StoryCorps, and we're going to fight body and soul, every cell of our body, to make this, you know, really take root and kind of move the needle in this country, we hope, on becoming a more kind of compassionate, thoughtful, better listeners, and a country that treats everybody with dignity.
All right, Dave Isay of StoryCorps. Thanks so much.
Thanks, Hari.